think are some of the booms that could be introduced?
Honest, of course, as the whole panel has been saying, basically the children follow your, they don't follow your advice, they actually follow what you do. So, I mean, you've got to first start doing things that you want the children to kind of follow. Secondly, on practical note, when we say, announce on the dinner table that, oh, I've cooked something healthy today, one doesn't need to do that because there's this whole huge connotation that healthy means tasteless. Healthy cannot be nice. And that's how children have also been brought up. It's there happening in the schools also. So a lot of changes can be just brought about as a kind of a variety or as a different dish. Okay, you don't need to always announce, now this is not fried, this is baked. Children just instinctively say, oh, then it can't be nice. So a lot of changes can be brought about without kind of making a much ado about being healthy. You can introduce variety. Also, in my, I had to give a talk to my in my children's school. The issue was that kids who used to get roti sabzi or paratha were kind of looked down upon or were laughed at, and kids who got pasta and pizza were like considered that yeah, that's the food to get and that's what you should be getting. I just had to explain to them that pizza, for that matter, is also roti sabzi, bread with vegetables on it, wheat based with vegetables on it. For that matter, burrito is also roti, corn roti with veggies, and our roti is also roti sabzi. So basically, any cuisine you see, the elements remain the same. But it's how you bring up children, what you kind of, the messages that you are conveying to your children is all that makes the difference. Because children don't come with preconceived notions. It's what we teach them.
So Ali, would you like to share one or two experiences you've had with your own children, you know, on how you persuaded them to eat healthy?
Well, first of all, there's a rule that's called the 20 times rule. And that rule says that in order for a child to try a new food, it takes them to see it 20 times. And most parents give up after the second time. This is actually research that has been done. So if you imagine that I bring you now something that you've never seen or smelled or tasted before in your life, and I say, eat it. You say, the first thing you say is, I don't want it. But imagine this thing, you see it every day on your dining table. Even if you're not supposed to try it, you don't have to, you're not pressured to do anything with it. But you keep seeing it, day after day after day. That by the 20th time, if you are a child, you will be ready to try it. Because it becomes part of your environment, it becomes a norm. And most parents will tell me, well, I've tried it. I said, did you try once? She said, no, I tried it 2 times. He's not going to like it in 2 times. Children need to, they're habitual eaters. Like any human, even adults are habitual eaters. So the 20 times rule actually does work. So no pressure, you put it on the table every single day for 20 times or even twice a week until you reach 20 times. And then you'll notice that by the 21st time he will try it. And then he will decide whether he likes it or not, and then he might need more time to like it. We want everything to happen quickly, you know, but I attended this book launch and she said X, Y, and Z, and this is your dinner tonight, and why aren't you eating healthy? And we get frustrated, and he won't eat healthy today, he won't eat healthy tomorrow. It needs patience, like anything with parenting, it needs patience and it needs perseverance. So the 20 time rule for me was painful at times, I have to admit, you know, there are times when you're tired and you have a headache and you haven't slept and you can't be bothered, and to be honest, I don't care what happens to your health, but you do, and you have to because you are the mother, and if you don't do it, nobody else will. And like Dr. Vijaya mentioned earlier, that if I'm the mother and I'm responsible to teach him manners, then I'm also responsible to teach him about his health, because parents say, oh, once in a while the Coke is fine. And I say, okay, so once in a while if he uses a bad word, is that fine? No, bad words, there's no limit, there's no minimum of bad words. You cannot say it ever. So I say, why do you relax your rules when it comes to food? And why is that not applied to behavior then? So you are the parent, you are responsible for this child's future, and just like you implement health behavior, natural behavior, you also implement health behavior. So you have to be convinced first. That's why I didn't write the book for kids because they're easy to convince. It's the mothers I have a problem with. We worked with several schools where we improve the diet of the whole school, and guess who comes complaining by the third day? It's the parents. The children have no problem. They're happy. They're just playing. If you give them stickers and you give them Play-Doh, they'll eat whatever. They're busy. It's the parents who complain. Oh, I'm sure he won't eat it. Give him time. So she didn't even give us 3 days before she started complaining. So it's the mothers that I need to convince, and the teachers, of course. So hopefully through you, we will help change the next generation. I'm sure.
So, Vijay, I know that you brought up your own children in your own individual style, and in Addison as well. Do you want to share a little about the kind of diet
what I really wanted to share with all of you is, as I say, substitute. Children will not know that the difference between a fried and a toasted, the sugar and honey or dry fruits you put, and if they have to touch it. And let me tell you, of course, I'm a scientist, microbiologist, biochemist. That's what's it do. When you learn biochemistry, you feel, wow, life is so beautiful, because that tells you everything about how precious your yeast cell is. And you go to microbiology, the whole world is your enemy. So how do you resolve it? So I said, I'm a scientist. I learned this as a scientific subject. How can I torture myself, my children? So that is how the introspection came. Then of course that is the time the nutrition was introduced in the psychology, physiology, social situation in India. A culture which brought up, even today, health is thriving in the so-called poverty. That's a different discussion I wish all of you can initiate. What is malnutrition? Who is sick? These are political important issues. So then, at that time, of course, I was looking for a career because I decided not to be a scientist with a professional tuition. I got married, wonderfully settled. I wanted a kid now, 1, 2, 3 kids. So everything, God's grace, ordered to wishes. So then I said it's time. Then I knew that the health is not what I would like, because my elder daughter became the so-called obese. So that's the time I knew about sugar. So I started one by one cutting down. Though you may say, do not, don't. My advice to all of you is, theoretically you really understand that this book definitely does justice to you. That's where I will begin, that's where I stop. Okay, please take this book seriously, whatever it is written about the heart, what you can't. I don't think a caring household should keep them in your kitchen. Do your shopping. So then I went to study. Then I knew here in the theory they talk about sugar, but in the practical class the sugar is not practiced. Same thing. So that set me.
So you're saying eliminate sugar.
Definitely eliminate sugar, milk and milk product. Of course, first I will say eliminate all kind of tonics and medicine. Whatever the unavoidable that's happening, that is why the body is tackling it. Purification. So that is a subject all of you need to get involved and discuss. Alright? And food is a way that you can give comfort at those times. That is when you need to know what is the stress you are creating in your digestive system, what is the stress you are creating in your mental system, and what is the unavoidable stress we allow to happen through the institution. So coming back to, so that was the time my three kids, I used to go and order the lab assistant. Chips, Abda found this cake. So I was coming home with 3 and 4 kids because I can afford it, I am getting it. So my children grew in that. 5 years happily. Then this was from the age of 10. Before that it was traditional. I went to study nutrition, and this is what they gave us as nutrition prasad. I was bringing, learning to make fried items, international foods and everything. And then I saw the health skipping and that set me thinking, and that is the time I knew about sugar, so sugar was avoided. And what I really did was I avoided everything and substitute. And in the table, whatever they were used was also there. My new innovation also came side by side. And they are very curious, Mama, why are you eating this? Sweetly, I feel like eating this, and it's really, and they saw me for a couple of months, I had severe migraine. The moment I stopped sugar, it vanished. That is how my research started. 15 years I introspected completely what is happening in the mainstream and RDA. I had to say it here if I am truthful to all of you and myself. Recommended dietary allowance is a mischievous tool. The process was introduced in 1943. And when I became a nutritionist, that was one maximum 100 nutritionists all over India. Now every other month there are thousands of nutritionists are sprouted. In 3 months they have all become professional. So whoever it is, get involved. It is easy to be very healthy. Everything has a substitute practically. I genuinely allow them to eat what they want to eat. And when they are sick, I say, sweetie, you overindulge. The next 5 days, 10 days, you are incorporated. They come around, they know. Now they themselves, my grandson especially, he was 3 months. He will say, the next 3 days I'll have my fruits, my vegetable juice, and don't disturb me. And even if I ask him, sweetie, because you are a mother, you are a grandmother, you are, how are you? Why are you asking, how are you? You only said, temperature is your friend. You only said that you boil the water to kill germ, your body is doing it. And he can give an extra for 3 years. 3 hours he is hardly 50. And add to it, he has not gone to school. Okay, and that is the courage you get out of life to brush out unnecessary. Life is long, life is beautiful. Please put the music and dance and eat whatever you want. Your body will like it. That's all.
The beauty of this discussion is that there's a lot of diversity. It's very nice.
It's very
really
India, full of diversity, Punjab.
You know, one thing I'd like to ask you, obviously we know that there are a lot of challenges today when it comes to eating healthy, being healthy. But are there any encouraging trends that are also emerging? Would anybody like to say? Come on,
I will say what? If I take 6 years to convert a person from sugar to non-sugar, now not even 6 minutes, thanks to everybody. So we had to concentrate collectively what you really think, the great the evil. They are really, I mean 3 days they are transformed, they have awakened. But you need to give them clarity. Charity begins from home, clarity begins from you. Charity without clarity is taking your own power. This, let this be the starting point for you to get involved, introspect again, and say that where are they? There you can't judge. Why I have to make the compromise? If the food for the child is really lots of vegetables and fruits and nuts and other things, why wouldn't I really go out of the way to do it? Why wouldn't I use the nuts? Why wouldn't I train my kitchen staff for that? It will come, that's a priority. You are taking the kid from kid to kid for checkup. Spend the time. So ultimately, health is the priority. Health is the choice you make how you are spending your time, space, and energy. It's as simple as
that.
I would like to say that the encouraging trend is that the fact that we have a full room here is a very encouraging trend. I think parents are more aware of the importance of health. We are reaching a time in life where there's so much stress and so many demands that you can't, it's very difficult to continue eating what we're eating and still feel good. We are forced kind of and cornered into finding solutions that will help us faster and quicker to get there. So when I first started practicing in Bahrain more than 10 years ago in the Middle East, health and nutrition was very sparse, a lot less than it is now. And only within a very short number of years, relatively, 10 years is a very short time, there has been a very big increase in demand. And I'm sure in India it's become even more. So doctors today are being cornered into answering questions about food, about nutrition, although it's not part of their main training. But there is a saying that says if doctors don't learn nutrition, then nutrition will be the doctors of tomorrow. Nutritionists will be the doctors of tomorrow. And I think in this day and age, if you don't go that route, it will be very difficult to maintain your physical health. So children today are getting diabetes earlier, they're getting obesity more than before. Before, when we were in school, the exception used to be the overweight child or the child who has acne. Now you walk into a classroom and that's more the norm. The exception is the child who is healthy. So we have to now, this is the time to get our weapons out and to start doing something about it, because it is the only way to deal with what conditions we have today. So this is the first step, and it makes me very happy to see the interest in the parents.
So Nani? You know, about Dr. Venkat will remember this, but about 20 years ago, my dad had ended up at your clinic with you, my father. He came to you 20 years ago. She won't remember. Then I landed up 5 years later. And my dad came home saying to me that, can you imagine the food I eat can heal me from your talk to him. And I was learning at that time, I was a student, and I was like, you know, yeah, I know that, but he says, you know, I've met a lady today who tells me that this can actually happen. Food is your medicine and food can heal you. And I'll never forget that day, because it was really a long time back, and Dr. Venkat has been my inspiration actually. That's where a lot of what I have done has started for me. She won't remember, because it was a long, long time back, but that's where I was inspired to kind of take on what I did in life. My dad unfortunately got prostate cancer and passed away because of it, but I think it was just before that he met Dr. Venkat. You know, I think the encouraging trend, and this is what I'm seeing more and more, is that people are connecting the dots, like Alia says. People are making the connection today that, listen, something that my child is suffering from is happening from the stuff that I'm giving the kid, you know? They've made that connection. So I think there's hope. This wasn't happening a while back. This wasn't happening when I was growing up, mind you. I was a child that was fed at least 2 liters of dairy a day. Came from a family of, my father was a non-vegetarian, my mother was a vegetarian, and he insisted on bringing up the children non-vegetarian. My mother didn't rebel, you know, she just went along with it. And lots of meat in our home, lots of ghee, lots of everything coming from, you know, they were from the Peshawar side, so you can only imagine the way they ate. And, you know, by the time I reached my teens, I was ridden with issues which no doctor could solve. I mean, primarily with the digestion, okay? And I went from doctor to doctor. I carried those issues into my early 20s. And my mother and my father, you know, I mean, you can't really blame them, because they were growing up in an era where it wasn't really, health wasn't so important. You know, they just grew up, you know, our parents just grew up. So I think today that doesn't exist. I see that with my brother's kids who are 9 and 7, that today the parents are willing to say that, listen, my kid has asthma, my nephew has asthma, and listen, there's something that the dairy is doing to him. You know, because I know now, being a counselor myself, that listen, dairy throws up in your lungs, and dairy has a way, it doesn't discharge from the body, and therefore it makes for a sticky condition. But now the mother is paying attention to that. She's actually making nut milk for him. She's actually taking that interest and going that long way for him. Something that they are realizing now, for example, even gluten, you know, this intolerance that is happening around due to gluten. We are a country that grew up on eating aate ka roti. You know, that's what we eat. We eat wheat all the time. But we are not sure the kind of wheat we're getting from the market. I mean, you know, and then there are gluten intolerances. So this is all coming into play now. So that's why I say this book has arrived at the right time. The time of this book is so perfect. And in fact, Alia was in touch with me much before the book was published, and I thought this book was, you know, the time had come 2 years ago, really, for this book. I think it's going to be a real revolution if people really get their hands on this book, because it's so rich with information for your kids. And you know, I mean, the change has already, it's happened. You know, it's not happening, it's happened. So this book is just coming to the right time. I think you guys should get a copy for yourselves.
Niti, what do you have to say about, are you seeing any encouraging trends?
Yeah, encouraging trends actually at different levels. So one is the public awareness is increasing. People are kind of connecting to nutrition more, that there are a lot of things which can be solved through just altering dietary habits. There's an encouraging trend even in the medical fraternity. Initially, doctors thought that they knew it all and they would say, don't eat this, don't eat that, and that's it. But now they are very, very open to sending the patients or sending the clients to nutritionists for expert advice, and they are acknowledging the role. So there's an encouraging trend there also. The other encouraging trend is at the availability of foods. More importantly, we are kind of going back to our own roots. Jawar and Bajra and Ragi, for that matter, millets, which were at one point looked down upon and were considered kind of poor.